Okay, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you are. And today I have a very special guest. He's never been employed. I know most of us are like, okay. Now, if you've never been employed, you wonder how you're going to go into business. Well, we have someone who's done it and you can learn from them. First, I'll ask him to introduce himself before he tells us his story. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Annabelle. My name is Omuga Ongo Ogwang.
All right. So when did you start business? What did you study? Where did you grow up? What's your history? And why did you go into business in the first place?
I grew up, I wouldn't want to disclose my age, but I grew up in the military. My dad is an ex in the military. And I grew up in the days that were remunerated kidogo sana. So I'm a firstborn in the family of six. What my dad would earn, I always tell people, you know how the Bible says that the children of Israel wore the same pair of shoes for 40 years and wore the same piece of garment for 40 years? I literally wore a trouser from class four. From class four all the way to form four. And I can't tell you.
You are not growing tall.
No, that's the magic. That's the magic. I can't tell you how the trouser would grow with me.
Oh my God.
So when the Bible says that the children of Israel literally wore the same pair of shoe for 40 years, I totally understand. So I grew up, and me being the firstborn, daddy could only cater for our tuition, our school fees. So I went to Kenyatta University Primary School, where I did my KCPE. And about that time of growth, you know, when you grow around an environment of lack, it either destroys you or it makes you better. So in this environment, we were so creative. My dad was part of what it's called non-commissioned officers. So sisi ndo tulikuwa wale watu broke, wale watu poor kwa military. Yeah?
Okay.
Military kuna two categories. Kuna commissioned officers and non-commissioned officers. So my dad was non-commissioned officers. Okay. And so the commissioned kids, wale walikuwa watoto uptown. Wale walikuwa na watoto kwa advanced sana. Uh-huh. And so out of that environment of lack, we would think a lot. And so when people grow around lack, they are very ingenuity, wako very ingenious, they are very creative of thinking of new ideas. And so one of the things that I stumbled onto was to make magari za wire.
Okay.
You know, I was very good at making gari za wire.
Yeah.
And so I perfected that skill. At class five, nilikuwa na make gari za wire, na uza 50 shillings at class five.
Which year was that?
I don't want to disclose.
I thought it's ladies who don't want to say their
No. Let me tell you, even men with the receding hairline, we are not comfortable.
Okay.
So I started with selling gari za wire. There is a skill that I didn't pick up, was a skill ile ya kujenga nini, gari ya mabati. Back in the days, their people would sell their product kwa tin, a tin sort of. And so we used to have Kimbo, we used to have Kasuku, we used to have Joma back in the day. And all these people would package their oil, edible butter. And so that is the only skill that I didn't pick up. And so I started with entrepreneurially. I started with selling gari za wire. I would make them, and I was exceptionally good. And that's the same thing I used to challenge my kids growing up.
Yeah.
That when I was coming up, we used to do things with our hands.
Yes.
And so up in your class 7, class 8, mm-hmm. of course, now uko mature, uko adole. So unajua, ukiunda magari za waya, mademu hawata kuconnect na wewe. So we used to have all that. So I graduated from gari za waya, and I used to rear rabbits.
Okay.
and so in primary school, I used to make gari za waya. When I went to high school,
yes.
That's now when I got broke, because for some strange reason, the school I went to, I think it's
juggle.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's called juggle. Oh, yeah. I couldn't juggle the two. So in high school, I didn't do anything. Yes. Mm-hmm. So, but just to answer you, so the path of being ingenious, the path of creating or thinking of how do I survive, because daddy could only afford tuition fee. Yes. So the thing, and I remember daddy would come to the house every end month, and it's something that I always appreciate him for, and he would give us his sleep, mm-hmm. his space.
I'm sure you.
Yeah, he would come. And you know, we are four brothers and, mm-hmm. and two ladies. Mm-hmm. The sisters walikuja nyuma. So daddy would come and say, gentlemen, this is what the government has given me. And do you want me to buy you shoes and clothes or to pay school fee?
Ah, okay. All right.
So that is how I started this. Then when I was growing up,
mm-hmm.
I entrepreneurship later in life.
Okay.
Yes, Annabelle.
I like your story. I mean that, I also think the fact that your father never hid anything from you made it possible for you to appreciate the worth of money, and that it doesn't come easy, or how shall I say, that it is attainable. So that at the end of the day, even though you saw there were hardships, you also thought about ways of making money yourself. I think that's, I mean, another child would have looked at it like, whoa, yeah, we are poor, those ones are rich. But I think you had a good network of friends, other boys, who got you thinking very innovatively.
I'm saying it's not something that was uniquely me, that I was creative. And I was saying the best thing that any parent can do to their kid, even if you have to, create some artificial shortage. When there is some sense of shortage, a person is forced to really think and ask themselves that, hey, but of course, shortage equally breaks others, while shortage actually make others. And so it was not only me who was imaginative or creative. We used to have kids all everywhere where we lived in the barracks. We used to have kids who are doing all sorts of things. Kuna watu wengine wana make fair, you know fair. And I'm telling you, they would sell fair. Those people would make a fair, and you think this is a weapon, you know. and so people grew.
So for anyone who doesn't know what a fair is, it is a sling that is made from twig and rubber band. Yeah.
But that's how. So there are people who would make fair. Other people would create strange things, like when I was rearing rabbits. It's my friends who actually, there are people who had specialized in making hatches, you know. And so that spirit of imagination and being ingenious and thinking was actually birthed out of an environment of shortage. And that is the best thing that I think God ever gave me. That I was brought up in an environment whereby we knew shortage, not lack, we knew shortage. Mm. And if you had, because the military would cater for food, the military would cater for things like sabuni and sugar and stuff. So the only thing that the military would not cater for, and if you come kubayanguo, and the salary daddy would earn, six of us, you know, and it's the best thing that I think I have. It's better than even my educational training. I really value that upbringing.
Okay. All right. Yes, so you were six kids.
Yeah, we are six kids. By the grace of God, we still are six.
Okay. So after that upbringing, you went to Kenyatta University, or where did you go?
No, I went to Kenyatta University Primary School, and then I went to high school. I went to high school in a school called Pehil High School in Migori, Pehil High School. Okay. And so while in Pehil High School, I didn't perform well in primary.
Let me ask. Okay. So we've talked, you after primary, okay, then you went to secondary school because your lot didn't have high school, if I'm not wrong.
No, we had a high school.
So you went to secondary, then you went to high school?
No, we had high school. Actually, you see that generation of 844 started around 1985. That is when 844 started,
right? Yeah.
So us guys who are coming up, we got gelled in into the 844 system. And so I went to Pehil High School, somewhere in Migori. And it's there that actually, like I said earlier, I didn't perform very well for my CE, my CPE. I didn't perform very well. And so when I went to Pehil High School, I went to Pehil High School under the guise that I'm a footballer. In that school, it's a provincial school. That school, you could only enter, you could only be admitted on one way. Either you're a bright kid or you're a sportsman, you're a footballer. And so my interview was this headmaster. I think he passed on. This headmaster took me to the pitch, and then akanambia, "Young man, what do you play?" Nikamambia, "I'm an overlapping midfielder." I don't even know what that is.
And what is it exactly?
I was an overlapping defender. That is what I told him, an overlapping defender. And so the guy was interested. really, let's take you to the pitch and let's see what you can do. So growing up, growing up, and so I knew my way around the soccer pitch. And so nikapepeta ball, who principal akasema, "Hey, who bought you mnoma?" So nikajipata Pehil. So
yes.
So yeah, kuna uboy, kuna skills. Kumbe siko na skills until the real people with skills showed up. and then I was excused from the football team. But something amazing happened when I was in Pehil. When I was in Pehil in Form 2, I interacted with the man from Nazareth, and I gave him my small heart, and that changed everything for me in Form 2. And so, like I told you, I was an average kid. I was not bright. Tulikuwa wale watu wanakam number 38 out of 43. Ukiperform sana ni 36.
But you know, there's different types of brightness. So you are not, you are just not what shall I say?
Academic.
Not gifted academically, but you're gifted in other areas. Yeah.
No. So I was not even gifted in other areas. It was just circumstances that forced me to pick up things. And so when I was in Form 2, I met with the Lord, and I gave my heart to the Lord in Form 2. And that is when everything changed. So when I am Catholic. And so nikaanza kuinquire then, how do I grow in my faith? How do I get upbringing? How do I get discipleship? So while there is when I picked up keyboard. And it came so naturally to me, picking up keyboard. And when I went to Form 3, something amazing happened. In Form 3, the church was planning to produce their album. And so, who is good at playing the piano? Omuga. They used to call me Omuga. Mm-hmm. And so they would say, sasa tunataka utuende program your beats. That's how they used to call it. You'd go with a keyboard and you program the entire instrumentals.
Okay.
And so I did that. And so yeah. I did that. And for 1 week, my old man used to earn 3,000. He used to earn 3,715, something like that. 3,715, something like that.
So that's around $30.
I don't know. Back then, it was just, anyway. So you would earn 3,175 or 78, something thereabout. That week, I went and I programmed for the church choir. That week, I was paid 11,000 shillings.
Wow. Almost that four one, times your dad's salary.
Not almost. That one, actually, it was like, what? I was given, and back then, we had the denomination. So the denomination that was the highest denomination according to currency was 200 shillings. So if someone gives you 11,000 in 200 shillings notes, you know. So according to, I'm very close with my mom. And so I went and I showed my mom honor. My mom almost cried. She thought I stole it. So she thought I stole it. Unaona vile nimeenda church? No, I'm Catholic. In Catholic, there are things we are not used to. So at what is a piano church? How?
Yeah.
So nikamwonyesha, unaona vile mifanya hivi? Imagine church imenilipa ni waprogramie beats. So my mom akaniambia pelekea your dad akutemee mate. Mm-hmm. And so I took it to my dad. My dad alichukua akanitemea mate, akasema may God bless you. Mm-hmm. May God bless you. That year my dad alisettle fee for all of us. It will fit for all of us. So akachukua 10,000 akaniachia 1,000 plus. That 1,000 inyaliniachia to nikaenda us guys we are four brothers. Nikaenda nikabuy my jeans. Nikabuy jeans. Mm-hmm. So tukakuwa na jeans that t-shirt. Unakumbuka I used to have that katroza ile ilikuwa ina grow na mimi.
Mm-hmm. Ah, I get now why it was growing.
And that, so when I went to Form 3, that first term, yeah, Form 3, from nowhere, from number 38, well, not number 38, that first term, I came number 4 in Form 3. Imagine ilitwa kwa assembly, like what has happened? Ever since, mpaka mali nimeenda campus, every degree nimeifanya, sijai kama number 2. Never in my life. Right? Wow. And that transformation happened largely because I met Jesus. God makes all of us better. And so when I was in Form 4, so we did our, I did my Form 4, kumaliza Form 4, sikupata poa. I got an A minus instead of an A. I wanted to be a doctor. So I missed it with 1 point. And about that time, right, akukuwa na vitu kama parallel. Unajua tu vitu parallel tumekam juzi.
Yeah.
So I was like, what else can I do? Uko disillusioned, uko disenfranchised, uko disappointed, discouraged, all those negative adjectives. So I was feeling all of them at one go. Mm-hmm. But also I'm glad, you know, if umetoka from kupata D all your life to a point whereby now unaweza katumika kama kielelezo kwa wengine. So this is what happened. Nika all through church, all through after Form 3, after I recorded that album, wakati tuko tumefunga, I would come and visit studios. And I would volunteer my production services in all most of these studios in Nairobi. So that is how I said, oh, if I cannot do medicine, then I'm going to do music and sound engineering. So I did music, and I've been producing music for the past, I think, 28, 25 years now.
Okay. So which university did you go to?
I wouldn't want to market them.
What did they do?
You know, they're not paying me to market them. But I did my music and sound engineering.
Yeah.
And so later, I also went to Uganda. I did my law degree in Uganda.
Mm-hmm.
And now I practice law. I practice a branch of law called intellectual property.
Okay.
Yes.
So that is how you got into intellectual property law.
No, this is how I got into intellectual property law. So one day, you see how when people unataka kufanya a selection, university selection, and then you have my first option would be to do this, my second option would be to do this, the third option would be to do this. I wanted, my first option was to do medicine.
Yes.
And then my second option was to do aeronautical engineering communication option. And then my third option was to do law. You can't come where serious lawyers, laws are, and then you say that you're bringing your guitar. They will not take you seriously.
You know? So being a lawyer, the pride also is there.
No, it's not the pride. It's an expectation that the community has on you.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
You can't appear where there is Professor so and so and Doctor so and so and Engineer so and so, and you're coming there carrying your nyatiti.
Okay.
So there's a time. There's a time actually when I get bored very fast.
Yes.
I get bored with people and I get bored with things very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And so in order for me, for something to keep exciting or for something to keep me finding it interesting, I must relook at every new thing that I could do.
Yes.
And so we had produced music. We had done music for churches. We had done music for people. And so one day when we're in the studio, some guy asks me, this is a black, eh? Man, let me ask you. Say, let them end up marry blacks. And then so father-in-law kulize. So my son, how do you pay your bills? Utamsho mazi will make beats.
Yeah, and in that generation, that would have been a big issue. Music was not something somebody did.
Music
a for story completely.
Music was for dropouts. Music was for people who are dealing in drugs. Mm-hmm. You know. So that thing really made me think. Eh? Now, by the way, let's go and kuoa. Nitambia my father-in-law me make beats. and so at some point, nikaanza kuuliza, by the way, my life.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a believer that individuals should always cultivate an interest to pick up life skills.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm always throwing myself at challenging things. Like this year, I had thrown myself to pick up a life skill of sewing.
Mm-hmm.
And so mina jaku shona. So every Saturday, there is actually a lady I used to go to, and I would pay her per month. Naenda anifunze kushona. So nikafunza kushona, kukata nguo, and to stitch. You never know when you'll need a life skill. The reason why most of us, we cannot explore is because we are limited with the things we can do. And so you're like, mimi tu ni lawyer. What will happen if today they waninyanganye my practicing certificate?
Mm-hmm.
Will I go and crawl somewhere and die? No, I will not. I have 10 different things I can do with my life.
Yeah.
I know how to apply chemicals. I know how to do stuff. So everything that every year, the thing that I do for myself is to pick up a life skill. And so this year, if you go through my Facebook, I used to put videos of me sewing. videos of me being skilled on how to sew, how to stitch, how to cut, stuff like that. Because
I totally get what you're saying. When we look at what happened with the neighbors of Turkey, the war that they had, what is that country called? Anyway, I was listening to BBC, and this couple who were living very well, when they got away from their country during the war, they found themselves with nothing completely, even though they could have run away, they could have flown away, but they just didn't manage to get anything, and they somehow had to survive. So luckily, the husband was an engineer, is an engineer, and the lady is actually a lawyer. But they had to adjust in the course of their journey. So in the process, now when they were passing through Germany, they were actually, the man was a gardener, and now the lady was a baker. So if they didn't have these skills, they would have been totally destroyed. Their family would have been over. Yeah. And we never know what life will bring to us. We never know what journey is going on ahead of us. So it's always nice to be prepared.
Very true. Like, I have a skill, baking. I'm very good at baking. I have pastry skills. Mm-hmm. Now I have skills that can apply. When you're doing your research, you should come. I'm very good at chemical application. I'm very good at chemical application.
Yeah, I'm a natural girl.
just in case. Now, the thing that I'm
stronger, plating.
The thing that would be my next challenge, you know, because God has blessed me with sons and daughters. That would be my next challenge. The thing that I always, this is a challenge that I give to my sons, is make sure you pick up a life skill. Mm-hmm. A life skill. Because guess what? You will, like you've rightfully said, you don't know about tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So majority of us, the only skill you have, so you're a journalist. Okay, so that's the only thing you can do, right? Mm-hmm. But if you're diverse, that one equally even gives you an opportunity as an individual to see how far can I stretch myself? Yeah. How far can I stretch my possibilities? Mm-hmm. Back in the day, I used to run a group of 12 companies, and the companies I used to run were all relying on my skill set that I had. So I used to have a company that does potato crisps because I'm very good in that. I used to have a company that does one, we used to call it art. We used to make t-shirts and stuff like that.
Not printing,
making t-shirts.
Stitching them.
Stitching. So there's this t-shirt. Guy used to, stitching the t-shirt back in the day. So now, if I was still running that company today with my skill of sewing, guess what? It'd still be afloat. Mm-hmm. So the thing that most of us makes us incapable is because we lack skill set.
Options, yeah.
Yeah, we lack skill set. And that is the thing that up to date, I'm constantly picking. Constantly picking. Because you never know where your skill set will take you.
Okay. And I mean, if someone is thinking that this would spread them too thin, again, the thing is that learning a new skill set doesn't mean that you're going into full-fledged business immediately, but it opens up the opportunity for you to think around things and possibilities, maybe create income streams, but then still it keeps your mind vibrant.
Let me give you something. The best thing that someone has, there is nothing that spreads you thin. The best advice I ever got, I got it from during orientation in Uganda when I'd got for my law degree. Mm-hmm. And this person asks us, why do you think this institution is called a university? Mm-hmm. And so people came up with different reasons why. Mm-hmm. And at the tail end, he said, no. The reason why this thing is called a university is because we are hopeful that an individual that comes out of this institution will have a universal appeal.
Okay.
That is the best definition I've ever gotten. And so this is what he was telling us. Have you come here to do law? Yes. When you don't have a class, can you drop into a maths class?
Mm-hmm.
When you don't have a cultural class, pick up something. Mm-hmm. So that at the end of the day, you will have a universal appeal. Mm-hmm. That I am an advocate, but I used to drop in economic classes. I am an advocate, but I used to drop in into the class I didn't drop in was called midwife. That one, for some strange reason, I feared it. Nursing and midwifery. That one I did not drop into.
Mm-hmm.
But the classes I dropped into, I used to drop into a lot of literature classes.
Mm-hmm.
Up to date, I still write. One of the things I do, I write music and I also write script. I still do economics classes. I used to drop into a lot of agri classes. Today, in my library, mm-hmm. I don't read some of these loosey-goosey books, how to be rich in 3 days, how to be, no. I read scholarly material because mm-hmm. scholarly material, they have a way of expanding your possibilities.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so this gentleman told us this again. He said, what are the usages for this hand or this arm, right?
Mm-hmm.
This arm or arm or hand, this hand, if I want to maintain my personal admin, it mm-hmm. is the same hand, right?
Yeah.
If someone invades my private space, it's the same arm that the hands that I will use,
yeah.
right? If I want to be friendly, it's the same hand. Mm-hmm. If I wish to cook, it's the same hand.
Mm-hmm.
So that gentleman told us, God did not create anyone limited.
Mm-hmm.
So that means you are not limited that you are only brought on this space to do maths or to do law or
yes.
to do journalism.
Mm-hmm.
That is the largest lie that we were ever sold.
Mm-hmm.
So that person said, you to master the same way your hand can master whatever you send, you expose it to.
Mm-hmm.
That is the same way you, as an individual, you can master anything. And so what I, from that, I read everything under the sun.
Yes.
Because out of that, you realize that this brain is not limited.
Mm-hmm.
It's us who limit this brain, either because we are lazy at an individual level, or we don't just have that curiosity. What else? Mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
So that is, in as much as we don't have life skill, the other thing is that this thing up here is limited
in what it
can to the extent of the information that you expose it to. So okay. People are like, mimi ni advocate to minda soma tu law books. Oh, mimi ni doctor to minda soma tu medical books. No, apana, stretch yourself.
Okay.
Yes, Annabelle.
Now, we already got to the place where suddenly you are telling us you had already opened the studio, but how did you get to open your studio?
Very good.
Get into that.
In the environment where I lived, mm-hmm. I used to live in Kahawa Barracks.
Yes.
And so outside the barracks, there were two brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And these two brothers, we used to be friends. And so they knew that I was very good with my fingers. And so them equally, they were exceptionally good. Their dad was a music lecturer at KU.
Okay.
Yeah, their dad was a music lecturer at KU. So their dad threw us a challenge
mm-hmm.
that why can't you guys develop the next sound for the entertainment scene in Kenya? That was the challenge. So guess what? We didn't have money. We didn't have resources to set up our own studio. So what we used to do is we would go to studios in Nairobi. And back then, there were only three studios in Nairobi. There was a Hitsco studio owned by Kasanga.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was the studio that is owned by Kibukosias, the Kibukosia. And then there was a studio owned by Ted Josiah back mm-hmm. then.
Yeah.
So those were the only people with studios in around. Not like today, anyone who has a Fruit Loops and a laptop calls themselves a producer. And so when we went to it was called nowadays they renamed it Sub-Sahara. Yeah, yes, yeah, Kibukosius.
Yeah.
When they were still a couple.
Yes.
When they're still a couple. And so we would volunteer our skill. We were very good at production. Have you ever heard of a group called Mandugu Digi?
I think so, but I am not sure.
Later in the day, we did a song for someone like Bamboo. We produced him, Pompey.
Okay. Yes. I definitely have, yeah. Yeah, I get
you. Okay, Pompey.
Yes.
We did another song for the guy who passed, Chris Kantai. Chris to the Cantera. We did that song. We have produced literally everyone under the sun.
Yeah.
Besides this new crop of emerging artists, Akina Willipola and the work now. And so,
but that other generation, onset, you did it. That was in the 80s.
Yes.
The
80s. No, in the early 90s.
Early 90s. Early,
2000s, 2000s, late 90s, 2000s.
Oh, okay. So yeah, it was after your university?
That one was way after. That was
okay. So I was thinking that you were doing this when you were in high school.
No, in high school is when I produced the first album.
Yeah.
Was for the church. I didn't even produce. I was only programming the beats.
Okay, you did.
And then after programming
for the church. Okay.
For the church. After programming the beats, and so we did it. There's a studio owned by Radio Aumenia Catholic.
Okay.
There's a studio where they own somewhere there, and so that one is what we did. So after that, a seed had
that's
been
around
sown.
City Market. Not City Market, but that road.
Up even in Thika Road.
Okay.
Thika Road. Mujia Furaha. There is something called Mujia Furaha on Thika Road.
Mm.
They have a very nice studio there for music. That's where they do all the production of the Catholic churches. So later we would offer our skill for pay.
Mm-hmm.
And when we were paid, we would assemble equipment, right?
Uh-huh.
Someone wants us to do this for them. The biggest gig we ever did was for, there is a German TV station called DW, Deutsche Welle.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. We did for them a sound score. When they were doing a documentary somewhere in Mombasa, those guys paid us 700,000.
Mm-hmm.
And we went and stalked the studio.
And so the
most beautiful thing that someone can identify in life is the ability, your skill set, to create for you revenue generating stream, your skill set. Mm-hmm. There is someone who needs, can you write? There's someone who needs it. The only problem is they don't know you exist.
Yeah.
Do you have a unique voice? There is someone who needs that voice to do something with it.
Yeah.
The problem is they don't know you exist.
Yeah.
And so the challenge is how do I avail myself to appear at a point of transaction when this person equally avails themselves at that point with their need? So that their need matches up with my skill set that I'm providing.
Yeah, and that's basically knowing what where your customers are, the platforms that you can find them in, and how you present and market yourself to them. Okay, so now you have started your studio, yeah, and you say you've operated this for about
25 years.
Wow, that's a long time. That's a whole person's lifetime.
I started producing when I was 18.
That's a whole person, a whole human being's lifetime. So, tell us, what challenges did you face? Or are there any things? I know, like, from our conversation so far, what you've said is that doors tended to open up for you, especially after your salvation. There aspects of yourself that you didn't know about that suddenly opened up, and we thank God for that. But even when we are in the Lord's, we are walking in the Lord's guidance, sometimes we are just human beings. We will face challenges, be it dealing with people or situations. Are there any challenges that you face?
There are challenges every day. There are challenges every day. And one of the challenges is, especially with my talent, the challenge was, how do you convert a talent into a career? Those are two different things.
Mm-hmm.
And because when we were starting, music was only covering up for that temporary need.
Yes.
Nataka kuva, nataka kung'aa. Unaona? So nataka kung'aa, nataka kuva. So ika graduate to nataka kujilipia fee. Because I remember when I went when I went and showed my dad fee structure uni, my dad told me this, gentleman, hata niko uza kila kitu ya nyumba. Nikauza kila kitu ya nyumba. Niende nichukue mpaka loan. Haitaweza all the 4 years. But guess what? God had introduced me to an opportunity that within a week I had made 11,000. Within a week. Right? So music and production paid for my degree.
Wow.
And I would work. And it's one of those things that I still have up to date. I have a tremendous work ethic. I'm this kind of a person. I will lock myself somewhere and work. You know, sinaga to excitement. I'm not this kind of a person that I'm outgoing. You'll always get me out there. No, I'm an introvert. I love locking myself somewhere and working.
Mm-hmm.
And so today, when I'm not developing music, when I'm not writing concepts, I'm studying, I'm working. So about that time, because you have to pay for your tuition. Na hii tuition, mzee hizi kai afford.
Yes.
So one way or another, this music thing must make it happen.
Must and deliver, so I
have worked in most of these churches. At some point, I was a choir instructor. At some point, you're moving in churches, looking for, hey, Pasi. You know how people would come and you go to a church. This is what I would do. I would visit churches almost every weekend.
Yeah.
Every Sunday. And so they would say, leo tuko na mgeni. Alafu ndaito mkono. Alafu nasema, bwana sifia sana wapendwa. Bwana sifia. Mimi ni Omuga, nimekuja kuwatembelea hapa. Mimi ni music producer. When people heard that, that one used to go like wildfire. And so the pastor would say, ndugu, tunaweza kukuona kidogo tukimaliza service.
How do you market yourself? Because until the guys that Jesus overturned their tables, really?
Yeah, and guess what? I needed this money, and this money was stuck somewhere, you know, in churches. Some of these worship groups did not even know that what they can record. And so there are churches I would go to, and the pastor would tell me, aki ya watu wangu ni wazuri sana. Ni skill ndia awana, na pia wajui kuandika. Guess what? Mi najua kuandika. So, literally, in Nairobi, your area, Kahawa Barracks, your area, ya Ruiru, Githurai, all that place, hakuna church sija producer music.
Wow. Okay. You worked hard for it.
Because the only thing is, back then I'm really born again. Not that now I'm not born again. Back then I'm born again. And I'm born again, nika kam kwa hiki tukutenderesa. There was that movement of tukutenderesa.
Yes,
Na movement ya tuk-tuk tenderesa ilikuwa ni real salvation. Hakuna ujanja, sijia tumeenda church, atumepias na we ni chali. Hakuna, unajua? So back then, siku wanataka kujichanganya, atinene nifanyo watu wa secular.
I get you.
You know, so I'm a believer, sitaki by then ni kwe disenfranchised from the congregation of the faith. And so the only people that would relate with me, mimi nimeokoka, na I'm a music producer. I used to throw that line. I'm a music producer. And they were like, oh, akibwana mekuleta kwetu. Yeah. The Lord has sent you to us. And I'm telling you, I used to produce albums. Mm-hmm. There's even a lady that I interacted with back in the day. The lady who has sung, Mambo ya badilika. Naona mambo ya kibadilika.
Okay, yeah.
Uh-huh. She's called Helena Ken.
Mm-hmm.
Back then, she used to be called Helena Kideka.
Mm-hmm.
Helena Kideka, I'm actually the person who produced her first album. Okay. In one of those churches I had gone to. Mm-hmm. In one of those churches. And it was called Nyakati wa Kutingizwa. The first song was, Uni wakati wa kutingizwa, chochote kitizika chokita tingizwa.
And you can sing as well.
I'm very good. My vocals are very good.
Okay.
And so, I used to do that in churches.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing that most of us, we don't know, like you've rightfully said, you need to identify, nani anataka kuproduce your songs?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know you would go to a church and sometimes this I used to set 2 days for kutwenda churches, Saturday and Sunday. Saturdays, I used to go to worship practices. And worship practices, I would look at those boys and I would say, mbona nyinyi mnaimba nyimbo za watu? Have you ever guys thought of you could be singing your own songs?
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, really? And I'm like, yeah, that's what I do. I'm a music producer, I'm born again. And I can walk you through. One of these days, you guys, people should come into for the service, and you guys are worshiping the Lord, singing your own songs. Mm-hmm. And you would go, you'd see the light bulbs go, ting, ting, ting. After tuition fee.
Okay, yeah.
Yes. So God has been good. God has been good.
So what would you tell 20-year-old you?
One. Plan.
Mm-hmm.
Plan. If I had planned well, I'm not in any way saying complaining, but if I had planned very well,
yeah,
chances are I wouldn't have been here now. Chances are. Right? Because there are 10 million opportunities that I did not maximize on.
Mm-hmm.
10 million opportunities that the Lord brought my way. This is the thing. When God brings something your way,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
God takes 3 steps backward and God looks at you and he asks, what are you going to do with it?
Mm-hmm.
God gives you something, you supply how far you want it to go. You remember the parable of this of the talent?
Yeah.
One person, they were given, 3 people were given. One was given 5, the other one was given 2, the other one was given 1.
Mm-hmm.
The person who was given 1 went and buried it,
mm-hmm.
right? But the person who was given 5 asked himself, what can I do?
Mm-hmm.
It takes a lot of plan in doing.
Mm-hmm.
That God has given me this, when God will want it back, it will not be in that form.
Yes.
And God will want it back.
Mm-hmm.
So if I was to advise the 20, and this is the thing that I always tell, even with my siblings or my children,
mm-hmm.
is plan. Never be limited in planning out of resources. Most of us, we don't plan because we think, sinner resources,
mm-hmm.
sinner resources. But if you just plan, resources will take care of themselves.
Okay.
Yes, Annabelle. Yes.
Wow. That is very enlightening. Planning mm-hmm. is really key. And of course, when you're planning, it also entails that you have a vision. that you can see where you're going, and you can actually at least have a general roadmap of how you're going to get there. That way, at least all the things that you need can be aligned to the purpose
Very
that you're looking at. All right. So what book are you reading now? You said you read a lot. What are you looking at now?
Now I am reading a book called, actually I was reading, it's still on my laptop. And it's, Nico, page 15.
Yeah.
I'm reading a book called The Israelites. A people, a mysterious people in a mysterious land.
It's written by Israelites.
Let me show you the Israelis. So that's one book I'm reading. Wait a minute. It's written by a Jew. I don't know how to pronounce it. Abraham Levicht. It's called Abraham Levicht.
Anyway, someone gets the title Israelites, chosen people, and then Abraham.
A mysterious people. In a strange land. So that's one. Two. I'm reading something called. There is a programming language called Python.
Yes.
So I'm reading Python. I'm trying to learn Python. I believe that in this time, for anyone to make sense, you must learn programming.
Yes.
It doesn't matter. Unaweza kuwa unapika ngumu, be a programmer. I'm really learning programming.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So if you were to talk to anyone or to have a meeting or dinner with someone dead or alive, who would you want to have that with?
There are many.
Pick one.
I would pick Jesus.
Why?
but anyway, I have two people that I would want to have dinner with.
Yes.
One, of course, is Jesus. I am fascinated at his intelligence and his wisdom. That this person, most of us, we confuse Jesus and Christ. Yeah. I'm not saying Christ, I'm saying Jesus, the son of Mary. The human person.
The human
person. Because the human person carried. So I would want to have a conversation with Jesus. I would save for last. This other one is the one I would go with first.
Why?
There's a guy called Jesus. There's a guy, of course, Jesus. You know, you save him for last.
To leave the good test.
For the last. You know, so there's a guy called Jim Rohn.
Yeah.
And that guy did not go to school. But the intelligence that guy has, I literally every day, I must listen. I listen to him when I drive to work. I listen to him when I get back, because I'm always all by myself. I listen to Jim Rohn, and his wisdom is on another level, it shows you what God can do with an individual if you can just avail yourself to God. And so those are the two people I would want to take out for dinner.
Okay.
I can only hope that I'll afford the Lord's bill.
No, he was a humble man. I'm sure he's not expensive to entertain.
Okay.
Okay. So you are Kenyan. Ugali or chapati?
Any. That is the hardest thing to ask a man.
Why?
A man must eat ugali, a man must eat chapati. Not necessarily in that order. I love ugali and I love chapati. There are things I don't regard as food. Something like rice. Rice is not food. There's this lecturer who would tell us, young man, why are you feeding on rice?
Mm-hmm.
Do you not know that in China, people who feed on rice are peasants?
Okay.
So the guy would ask, how many peasants do I have in this class? You know, men don't feed on rice. And so I don't feed on rice, juice.
Yeah.
I only feed on two things. Ugali and chapati. Ugali and chapati.
And nothing, you don't like one more than the other?
Not really.
Okay.
Not really.
So you have your ugali with?
Of course, I'm a Luo.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm to really compromise, it's ugali and fish.
Uh-huh.
And staple diet would be ugali and gweno.
Uh-huh.
Or ugali and aliya. We have a particular type of meat that is traditionally prepared called aliya.
Yeah.
So, but when I want to compromise. When I want to dilute my Luo-ness with westernization, I will go as far as fish.
Okay, and if it's chapati, the same.
Chapati is this thing. What do we call it? Gueno.
Okay.
Chicken.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. All right. So one last word.
We live in a phenomenal time.
Mm-hmm.
And in this time that we live in, all of us, let me tell you, not every one of us was built to start business.
Mm-hmm.
There are people we started business with that they are now belly up. Eh?
Mm-hmm.
Not everyone was created to be an entrepreneur. I'll be lying. Entrepreneurship is madness.
Mm-hmm.
Total madness. You need to have another level of resistance and shock absorbers just to make it through a day in entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm.
I told you earlier, but there was a time I used to run an organization which was called WIFA Group of Companies.
Mm-hmm.
And WIFA Group of Companies used to have 12 companies.
Mm-hmm.
Today, of the 12, do you know the ones that are still surviving?
Mm-hmm.
Two.
Wow.
Two.
Okay.
You know. It's because when I started, nilikuwa tu na ile excitement, hey, things are happening. I didn't have a plan,
mm-hmm.
right? And so now that I'm here, mm-hmm. right? If there is a thing that you need to do, in as much as we live in incredibly phenomenal time,
mm-hmm.
you need to equip this thing up here.
Mm-hmm.
I used to have a teacher who used to call it this big box dangling from above you call a head.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy would say, stock it with content.
Yeah.
Stock it with content. Because this thing has the ability to guide you throughout life.
Yeah.
And so, yeah.
Read. Get information. Learn.
Yes. Yes. Make yourself better. Better.
Self-improvement.
And if you can,
yeah.
If you can, please pick up a life skill.
Yes.
In your day, what time do you wake up? At my age, I wake up at 3 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
I sleep strictly at 9 p.m. I don't watch news.
Mm-hmm.
So I do that, and I've been doing that for the past 20 plus years. I wake up at 3 a.m. Hapo mali penye unaishi, kuna salon. And I go volunteer, say, I want to wash nywele za watu. Right?
Mm-hmm.
We osha nywele. Hey, ningependa ku... Like yesterday, I was telling someone, I'm very good at threading. You see this thing that women mm-hmm. do called threading?
Mm-hmm.
I'm very good at threading.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a life skill that I picked up. I can't tell you the last time my wife alienda salon kufanya threading. I can't tell you, baby. I'm very good at threading. You know? And so, as a human being,
yes,
be as versatile as possible.
As you possibly can, yeah.
Kuna mali hapo karibu na mali kuna bucha. Volunteer your services. Mami enda kuoshia. Nataka kuja vile nyama ukatwa.
Mm.
Just gather life skills.
Mm.
Gather life skills.